Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention. Today I would like to highlight how whole genome sequencing is used in my world of regulatory food microbiology safety testing, with a particular emphasis on how we're addressing quality issues through the activities of the bioinformatics technical group of the GCRSR in conjunction with other collaborators in the international genomics community. Regulatory actions to mitigate exposure of consumers to foodborne microbial hazards are underpinned in part by laboratory testing of samples recovered from food manufacturing and distribution environments by inspection staff. Testing routines typically involve the steps of enrichment culture to yield a colony isolate on plating media, followed by definitive identification using a variety of tools. Traditionally, this consisted of biochemical tests to verify type reactions for the identification of phylogenetic characteristics. This approach provides a low level of resolution and is very time consuming, often taking many days and up to 2 weeks in certain instances before a test result could be issued for regulatory action. The advent of leading edge genomics technology, particularly whole genome sequencing and bioinformatics workflows to process the resulting large datasets, has enabled an unprecedented level of detailed characterization of food bacterial isolates to pinpoint their identity, to determine their virulence characteristics, as well as to match isolates from various sources using high resolution fingerprinting techniques to establish causal relationships. To ensure a solid foundation for regulatory decisions, it's imperative that methods used to provide evidence and characterize contamination events are accurate and reliable. For this reason, regulatory agencies worldwide subscribe to common quality and method validation criteria. Traditional methods such as enrichment, biochemical ID, and even PCR-based approaches often follow prescriptive protocols which are evaluated in the wet lab using biological materials, and as a result tend to be rigidly locked in with little scope for flexibility. So for example, ad hoc queries which may arise during a food safety investigation. On the other hand, WGS-based approaches may have a prescriptive wet lab component, so for example, the sequencing, chemistry, and process, but the analytical routines for the processing of the ensuing large data sets tend to be highly variable in terms of computational approaches and environments, as well as the nature of bioinformatics workflows, which will vary according to application or the nature of the questions being asked. In fact, this latter point is germane if we are to obtain the maximum value from WGS technology, which needs to remain flexible to allow a broad scope of inquiry. Standards are well established internationally for the validation of traditional analytical methodologies. In Canada, the joint CFIA Health Canada Microbiological Methods Committee requires that in order to meet regulatory requirements for inclusion in the compendium of microbiological analyses, or microbial analytical methods, the methods must demonstrate certain performance characteristics as outlined in this slide. Note particularly the rather limited number of actual bacterial strains used to put the method through its paces in order to ensure its ability to arrive at the correct answer with a representative and hopefully diverse panel of bacterial isolates or strains. The problem with WGS-based approaches is that much of the analytical output is based on the computational analysis of the sequencing data. And in this regard, these algorithms or workflows may be regarded as a type of analytical methodology. However, unlike wet lab methods, for which operational materials and conditions can be strictly controlled and standardized, bioinformatics tools are not readily amenable to evaluation using the same types of approaches. Because of the variety of applications possible, the need to keep these methods open-ended to maximize their potential, and local variabilities in computing environments and algorithm structure. The foregoing limitation is why we advocate for a different approach to validate bioinformatics workflows, and even to capitalize on the tremendous resource that lies within the collective whole genome sequence datasets to enhance validation protocols for wet lab methods. In our approach, we account for the diversity of workflows and their application environments through proficiency verification as opposed to prescriptive method protocols. In the former, the end user operates the method of their choice to suit their circumstances, but must demonstrate the ability of their workflows to generate the correct answer through the analysis of benchmark genomic data sets representative of the target microorganisms, which would be inclusivity panels in the normal validation parlance, as well as interfering organisms or exclusivity panels that are likely to occur in test samples. These benchmark datasets are comprised of well-curated, authenticated WGS data from panels of target, non-target, potentially interfering bacteria. Such a data set should be representative of the broad diversity of target and non-target organisms known to exist in nature. One advantage of such data sets is the ease with which they can be made publicly available through platforms such as NCBI. So, for example, we've deposited panels of well-characterized salmonella genomes for use in international antimicrobial resistance benchmarking. Such resources may serve as a very useful tool to foster harmonization of end results in different analytical environments, as well as providing valuable data to supplement wet lab method validation studies. The CFI has amassed a large number of bacterial isolates recovered from inspection samples over the years, resulting in a collection of nearly 3,000 isolates, which is highly typical of naturally occurring pathogens and hence very representative and relevant for present purposes. In addition, there are very large publicly available databases of food pathogen WGS data with verification for sequence data quality and curation. This is a rich resource for the creation of benchmark data sets. While we are only at the cusp of developing benchmark data sets for our purpose as food inspectors, to date we've made a good start of establishing benchmark data sets representative of some of the key bacterial pathogens targeted by CFIA inspection programs over the years. So note that this is a work in progress, and of course we have every intention of increasing the number of well-curated WGS data sets corresponding to the genomes of various foodborne pathogen bacteria of interest to our inspection programs in Canada, as well as internationally. As part of our curation process, we developed a number of tools to verify the quality of genomic data sets and also to determine certain characteristics such as diversity and representation of the data sets in question. So one tool that we've developed to evaluate the diversity of genome collections is the Diversitree, which uses an MLST type approach to create phylogenetic trees of data sets comprised of WGS data for a defined set of strains. This is important if one wishes to ascertain that a panel of strains used in an evaluation study is sufficiently diverse and representative of strains likely to occur in nature. An example of how these genomic databases would be used to supplement wet lab PCR primer validation studies using an in silico PCR system, which can predict the likelihood of producing an amplicon with a given primer set. Another example would be the evaluation of bioinformatics workflows on the basis of a proficiency approach, in which labs demonstrate the ability of their tools to achieve the correct answer by running a benchmark data set. The quality of WGS data sets will have a significant impact on downstream bioinformatics processes, with one critical element being the possible presence of adventitious DNA sequences due to contamination during sample handling and sequencing operations. The Bioinformatics Working Group of the Global Coalition for Regulatory Science Research is hosting an ongoing project addressing the need to assure WGS data quality by accounting for contamination events through the determination of their impacts on sequencing and on downstream analyses, such as typing or gene marker discovery, for example, when you're trying to determine the presence or absence of virulence factors or perhaps even phylogenetic markers to establish the identity of an isolate, and perhaps even also antimicrobial resistance genes. The possibility here is when you have a contaminated genome data set, it's possible that you could actually have false positives because of contaminating the presence of adventitious gene markers from the contaminating material. So the goal of this particular study was to determine the impacts of sequence data quality on downstream analyses, including gene marker discovery and high-resolution typing, commonly used for food safety risk assessment and risk management purposes in the world of food inspection and regulatory actions. In silico, in this project, in silico WGS data sets predicated on veratoxigenic E. coli as an example of a priority food pathogen were created for deployment to 7 participating labs in both the EU, the US, and in Canada, along with a standardized reporting format. And these veratoxigenic E. coli data sets were contaminated to various degrees with different strain WGS data sets. Most laboratories' WGS assembly pipelines were actually very good at reporting clean sequences in this study. This figure shows an analysis of the results obtained from the seven laboratories. It's kind of a snapshot, a bird's eye view, if you will. There will be more detailed analysis forthcoming, but for today's presentation, I thought I'd highlight some of the overall results that were obtained and observations. So, and what we noted is that as sequence contamination levels decreased, so we had various levels of contamination from clean, i.e. no contamination, then 10, 5, and 1% contamination. That is to say that those percentage would represent the level of contaminating WGS data that existed in the VTEC strain data sets. And what we found is that as the sequence contamination levels decreased, the accuracy of detecting low level contamination also decreased. So labs were generally pretty good at determining high levels of sequence data contamination, but this falls off as the contamination levels get lower, perhaps not surprising. The detection of target genetic features such as MLST profiles and the presence or absence of specific genes was also somewhat impacted by contamination levels. As you can see here, the results for different gene markers that were examined in this study. Of course, the impacts being greater at the higher levels of contamination. So in future studies, we will actually be investigating the impacts of different bioinformatics tools, as well as the qualitative and quantitative differences in the detection of target gene alleles. I should note here that the laboratories that were participating in the study were able to use the bioinformatics workflows of their choice. And we do have the information recorded on our standardized reporting sheet. And so that will be taken into account when we do the full detailed analysis of results. So with that snapshot, I hope that I've been able to convey the impacts of sequence data quality on downstream analyses, and also how well-curated data sets can serve as an important adjunct in the validation of both wet lab methods and in silico analytical workflows for better harmonization of method performance and ultimately regulatory outcomes between laboratories and regulatory authorities, both within national jurisdictions as well as internationally among trade partners and so on. The fact that these tools can exist as databases means that it should be relatively easy to share and standardize among labs in different jurisdictions. And so this work will contribute to the development and implementation of harmonized quality protocols for the application of WGS technologies in the international regulatory food microbiology community. And of course, the work is the concept of benchmarking datasets is of course expandable to other, non-food microbiology related applications. So this is important not only to assure the quality of analyses underpinning regulatory decisions, but also to level the playing field and ensure fairness among international agri-food trade community. The members of the bioinformatics technical group will continue to work together in undertaking projects to advance scientific collaborations and to maximize the benefits of WGS technology in support of the international regulatory community. And I thank you very much for your attention.